I would normally ask you to sit, but we've had a bereavement for the councillor John Cowell passed away or something, and I'd like you to stand to bereavement.
John Cowell.
To receive apologies from our friends.
Thank you, Chair. Apologies also from councillor Buchan, Cassidy, Smith and Thomas.
Chair, I'd like to declare what I believe is a prejudicial interest in 12.3 on the agenda. And I believe you will not be able to.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Before we get into the business of the meeting, I'd like to make a statement. Recently on social media, a heavily edited video of me and Peter proudly celebrating following the Sevenfold Council meeting in which we voted successfully to sign up on the new budget, which will continue to tackle labour deficit in Hartlepool. As a coalition, we've been successful at doing this throughout the last 9 months, working together to deliver for our borough. Sadly, Labour voted against all of our new measures, but we narrowly got it through and have begun the process of giving back to the whole of Hartlepool through new and exciting investment plans. A tiny section of the overall full meeting's worth of film was cut and edited in order to try and discredit me. It failed, may I add. This clip, in fact, showed my relief for a lot of hard work to get a new budget through that protects vulnerable adults and children who are in looked after care. And as I said on the night, also secured much needed investment for our borough, which all of us will benefit from. I am sure that the overwhelming majority of people in this room and the borough of Hartlepool generally want this hate culture to stop the attacks on others and actually want to work together to improve the whole of Hartlepool for the better. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. We will move to 3, to see if any business required by statute to identify any business. Okay. To approve the minutes at the last meeting of the council held on the 19th of December, that's the correct record. Is everybody
agree?
Okay, agreed. Councillor, questions from members of the council on the minutes of the last meeting? Is there any? to deal with any business required by statute to be done. There isn't any. To receive any nonsense from the chair on the head of paid service. I've got a couple. I've got a charity evening on the 4th of March. It's going to be in the Cricket Club in Pakistan. It's £7 a ticket for £5 and the Phoenix Showgirl for the entertainers. I would really appreciate if members could come. It's a Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock, and it should be a really good evening. Okay. Also on the 20th of March, at Flagship, we're having a lunch, and that will be on the 20th of March on a Friday, 3-course meal, that will be £18 in the College of Better Education. After the meeting, I'd invite people to come back to the parlour for a drink, to try and raise some more money for my charities, which are the Great North Air Ambulance, Pansy's Breast Cancer, and also Harbour, three very worthy causes. So there'll be the skips, and also I bought the wine and beer in for myself. It hasn't gone to any council points, and there's a box at the end of the bar. If anybody would like to make a donation, it would be very welcome, thank you. Item 8, to dispose of business at any remaining from the last meeting and to receive a report of any committee to which such business was referred for consideration. Okay. 9. To consider reports from the council's committees and to receive questions and answers on any of those reports. Jed, I believe you want to do the report of our committees.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The findings of the audit of Jones Committee a month ago in January, preparing findings from the council, full council tonight. On the 22nd of January 2020, the audit of Jones Committee considered a report from the Deputy Monitoring Officer following a complaint about Councillor Antonio Richardson. Complaint had been made by Councillor David Black and related to a series of Facebook posts that had been shared by Councillor Tony Richardson on his Facebook account. The posts that had been shared were of a racially offensive nature. At the hearing, Councillor Tony Richardson accepted the findings of the report and accepted that it breached the code of conduct. Councillor Richardson apologised to the committee and explained his actions was not racially motivated, but it was attributable to his naivety and his difficulties in using social media. The committee was invited to consider what, if any, actions it should be imposed upon Councillor Richardson. The committee had imposed a number of sanctions that are within the committee's power, but there are always additional sanctions that are considered by full council today. So, Madam Mayor, I regret, therefore, what move the recommendations contained within the report, and could be a second of the recommendations.
Yes, sir. It's obviously a good complaint. I'm aware that there are comments made tonight and this evening with regards to other things that people want to bring up, and I think people should be acceptance of the fact that what was said and what Tony has then, sorry, Councillor Richardson has then apologised for. It doesn't make it right. But I think what we need to realise is that this isn't representative of the it's not representative of the people, and it's being dealt with, and in the electorate will vote whether they agree with this.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
what was said and shared absolutely abhorrent. But that's not the reason why I want to speak tonight, because a lot of people have accused the council of not having good standards, and we'll be using that standard because the law that was abolished. It was abolished for a number of reasons. The Local Government Act 1972 and our one constitution quite clearly states that anything we do in the council must be within the law. The recommendations within the report bear in mind Councillor Richardson has admitted naivety and ignored his unknown about the use of Facebook, ignored his suggestion that the law has been broken. And that's what we are basing the decision on. That's what we asked as a council to make decisions on. And yet there has been no formal investigation by the police to say that the law has actually been broken. So I'm somewhat uncomfortable at this moment in time making a decision when we still await the outcome of any pending police investigation. And on a police investigation, I was a fraud manager for 6 years in East End. I dealt with a lot of prosecutions. And if the assumption is when you go to court is you make charges and it's beyond reasonable doubt. Yet it's separate in council because we make decisions based on probability. But I actually think probability in this case, for all the sharing, is absolutely abhorrent. It's not enough. The report is based on probability, and I think that's a much weaker test than what the police would consider being beyond reasonable doubt. And the foundation upon which our decision tonight has to be made is going to be made on a foundation that is probable rather than beyond reasonable doubt. And we have standard and recommendations that come before us tonight, and we haven't waited for the outcome of the police investigation. If they deem it necessary, then they believe that a crime has been committed. I believe that the timing of this, I don't have a problem with the recommendations if the outcome of the police is that a crime has been committed, but I firmly believe that this report should be set aside until we know the outcome, because what could happen is that the police could hold their investigation, actually determine that other people have access to that Facebook page. Other people could have shared those posts. And Councillor Richardson has admitted it because he also had access to it. And he is saying that he may have, and he too is absolutely disgusted, with the comments. But I think it's right and proper for us to set that aside until we have got a definitive answer from the police whether or not a crime has been committed. And in the media over the last week, and just
to say, I can just imagine
you've gone over 3 minutes. Just a very short point. In the media, over this last week, there's people who have been hounded by the press for decisions that have yet to reach court and have had dire consequences on the lives of them and their family, and therefore, I think it's unfair for the council to make a decision tonight.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have a couple of points. First of all, could I ask we put some clarity on perhaps in Councillor Richardson's, and if you refer just to Councillor Richardson, and even in the report itself, there are several areas where it just refers to Councillor Richardson. Could I ask that we are very specific on which Councillor Richardson it is going forward, and also could propound the rule for a council put out a statement
Thank you. for example, reasons it's not the council's
Okay.
Secondly, the Labour would believe that the costs that were shared on Council Tony Richardson's vote, comparing brown people with dogs, inferring that people of colour swell and don't work, and they're openly a drain on our society, are not only innately racist, but open the door to a barrage of vitriolic racial hatred from the margins of our society, which I will not repeat out of respect for this chamber. Fortunately, these were drowned out by the disuse and outrage voters, calling for Councillor Tony Richardson to resign. Let me be clear, the idea that once we are elected, we unequivocally carry the support of the general public that voted us in is an absolute nonsense and something some councils should learn fast. We are travelling after our own, regardless of race, religion or background, and these bigoted sentiments are in direct conflict with that. We believe it is vital that all councils from across the floor ensure that this kind of rhetoric never enters, the mainstream, so these racist and bigoted malcontents remain marginalised. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
First of all, I think there's a difference between the law as it stands and the ethical law that I think we are responsible of upholding within the council. So I think that we should be able to go ahead with the decision tonight, even if the police inquiry hasn't actually finished, because of the ethical law that we uphold. And secondly, as far as I remember, the Audit and Governance Committee, whenever we did the case, actually expressed their surprise at the fact that Councillor Tony Richardson hadn't actually resigned before it had gone as far as it went.
Okay, thank you. I was at the same meeting.
Yes,
I can thank you for that. Councillor Richardson.
Yes, Chair, just for your information, in the report, it mentions Councillor Richardson 14 times. I am completely different from Tony Richardson. I'm being committed, anti-racist, anti-fascist. I was a founder member of the Anti-Nazi League. I represent a large proportion of the Asian community in my ward, and I'm fairly respected by that community. So it's outrageous that in this report, that people know that there are two Richardsons here, and I've been associated with this. And there's some people outside who don't know the full workers of the council think that it's me. So I would hope that that report will be altered and amended. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor
Cowan.
Like I said before, in the actual report, it is clear that an assertion against Councillor Tony Richardson and also on the report of the case reference, it says concern on Councillor Tony Richardson. So if you read it all, you will know which Councillor Richardson is.
Share button. However, you should have pressed the delete button, so I'll write that button.
racist and are being targeted for that. There's only some people in this room who remember who have been videoed and harassed by racists, because we've always stood up for our community. No matter who our community are, we've supported them. And Hartlepool has a true history of support and welcoming people to Hartlepool, and we can't lose sight of that. What I would like to say on this tonight, I think there's a level of hypocrites in the room, because I've witnessed racism in the Labour group. I've heard a reference being made, which I won't mention tonight, in the past, which was just terrible. I've heard the situation, I've got papers, which I'm happy to share with anybody, with vile comments denying the Holocaust and statements which have been made around our Asian community. And some people on this side of the chamber have seen sight of that and have kept silent, and that's a crying shame. What I think we need to do, we need to root out racism. And if Councillor Richardson is a racist, he should be handed out of office, and the people will make that decision. But what I do know is I'm not a fan of Tony Richardson. We've had our disagreements over the years and had quite some standard arguments. But I think, personally, he's a very good councillor. Tony Richardson is a very good councillor, community councillor, and he does work. And I'm a little bit suspicious that some, and I say some, are using it to discredit. Now, if he has done it, then I think he should go, and only he knows if he shared that information. So I would like to second, or Christopher did as well, just said tonight, that we defer this, let the police have it, and investigate. But I also think, and we'll be discussing this further, that we should have an independent inquiry into this, so it can be looked at independently, and we can examine, because what's being brought out tonight about people sharing the information will come out. But I think what we do need to do as a council, we do need to unite against racism like we have in the past. And we need to not just pick and choose who it is. If we've got racists that amongst us, let's challenge them, let's get them out, let's deal with them. But it makes us equally worse when we sit back and we know one of our colleagues is a racist and we do nothing about it, and we pick and choose our fights. That is wrong, and I think we need this independent investigation. I've got every confidence in the chair who done that investigation. There's no criticism for the panel, but I think there is. When you don't look at this, and it's a political agenda here, it's open to abuse. So I would like to set to that.
I'm not just saying that I haven't been after the real planning. The real conservative obviously has papers that suggest there's racism in the real planning to be presented to the system. Because I have experienced racism in the 4 years of the university. He's going to make those sort of statements. He has to back them up.
I already have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
If I can, it's a third in third of the group that was having a motion and moving against. Is
local government finance settlement, which sets council tax referendum limits and details the national increase in core spending power, i.e. the national amount councils will have to spend next year. While the increase in spending power is welcome, this does not fully address the budget pressure we face. More significantly, the government's forecast increase in spending power assumes all authorities will increase council tax in line with the government's council tax power. Referendum limits. And this accounts for 55% of the national increase in spending power. The government's council tax referendum limits continue to shift funding for local services from the national taxation on council tax and means that authorities either increase council tax in line with these limits or reduce spending on services to offset the resulting reduction in carrying council tax income. In December 19, the 2020-2021 council tax increase for council services was agreed, which included a 2% social care precept. Secondly, the report deals with the statutory arithmetic calculations of the overall council tax level, which includes council tax levels set by the Police and Crime Commissioner, the Fire Authority and Parish Councils. As explained in the report and in previous years, because we don't have former Councillor Thomas to ask the question, these statutory calculations are the legal responsibility for the council as a billing authority for the area. The only grounds for not approving these calculations is if the member identifies an arithmetic error in the calculations detailed in the report. By law, a recorded vote is required to approve these calculations. Thirdly, section 9 of the report covers the specific recommendations referred from the Finance Policy Committee in relation to additional borrowing for the capital programme and investment of Greyfield recreational ground and pavilion. The recommendations are in two parts, and separate recorded votes are needed for the recommendations in paragraph 9.1 covering the statutory council tax calculations and paragraph 9.2 covering borrowing recommendations. I put the report.
To protect the school. and unfortunately the members at the time voted this through. And one of the things we were hopeful of with the site is something good will come out of the site. And I would like assurance tonight that Breeden will not be forgotten about and that something positive will come from that. The second point I want to make is around the police. I've well and truly lost faith in the police and have very little, if any, respect for the way that the force has been handled and the troubles in this force. And I just don't think hardcore residents are getting value from me when you have a resident in my ward attacked in their own home. And you've got the resident who didn't respond, at least didn't respond. And you've also got a situation where there's somebody running around with a machete for 35 minutes in the house wall, and the police took time to respond to it. And it's a good vote against it tonight. I think we would, but we know we can't. But I just want to have on record that I'm absolutely disgusted at the way that police are caring at the moment. There's no questions from the Barry Cottinger. I've got a lot of time for Barry, but from an operational point of view, things need to change. We hear the noise that things will change, but it's just absolutely appalling. And we welcome tonight public increase and residents seeing decline in police services, and they're just not getting the response they need.
I think the first part of that. And I did answer about the issue that Breeden does have the future. There are plans on the Breeden site, and there will be a significant amount of investment in the Breeden site as well. And we look forward to Breeden moving forward as our principal outdoor playing pitch.
And if I could just say, about 5 or 6 weeks ago, as a member of Art and Governance, we were asked if anybody wanted to go out with the police on Friday night or Saturday night. And I did go out to the council to say they would go out with the police. And I couldn't get either, it was like a ghost town. There was just nobody around anywhere, apart from an accident at Friday night, 8 till 10. Well, it's about 10:15 when I'm going to drive back up again. And it was so quiet. But I know a lot of things have happened since then, so it's it once we get busy again, we'll be glad to talk and share with you. Councillor Harrison.
Thanks, Madam Chair. Can I just put you right on a couple of things? There are other councillors who have expressed an interest to go out with the police, and that's in hand.
Right, you were the only one. Well, at the time, there was only
one. No, but you weren't actually the only one.
Well, that's what I was told, that's all I can say.
I
got by what I'm told. Councillor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just to reassure the Council of Exposure, I'm going to speak with the police panel along with Councillor Hunter. There has been significant changes made by the Chief of Police, and we will see them come through, so please be reassured that I have a full assurance that our reduction of police will make a better direction for the town. So just to maybe advise a few of the meetings and talks, action for what he's done.
Marshall.
Four. Councillor Carver Dixon.
Four.
Councillor Stokel.
Four.
Councillor Tennant.
Four.
Councillor Ward.
Four.
Councillor Ewing.
Four.
Bungalows for those younger families who need them, as well as the
There's a couple of things I want to say on the report. The first is, within the report that we sent the council tonight, under 7.1, it says, financial business plan was considered by financing policy on the 10th of February. And normally, the background papers would be included in something so important as what this is. And I would just like to put on record at that meeting, I voted against it on one key principle, that the part of the business plan was based on increasing the rents of council houses by 1% above inflation. I also put a case forward with the announcement that there will be Whitney Garden Village, there's going to be more 106 monies, that we could achieve the same number of affordable houses for Hartlepool without increasing the rents for the most vulnerable people in the town. And people who are on benefits, actually, their rent increase may be covered because they're at a low end of the scale. But we know that more people are experiencing family poverty who are working, the working poor. And not only are we going to impose a council tax increase on them, but we are going to impose a rent increase, which, if my memory serves right correctly, is over £2 a week. That might not seem a lot, but if you put that on top of the council tax increase, then I actually think it is unfair when you are giving on one hand social housing and you are taking it away with the other hand, then you are increasing the rent. I would like a separate vote, and I would like us first of all to consider whether or not we should be increasing the rents on council houses before we take this vote tonight. So I would like to move that this report only comes forward HRA business plan if it does not include a rent increase for council housing in Hartlepool. And I think everybody is saying that one of the main pillars of this council is to tackle family poverty. Then what is the way to do it? Then to put our money where our mouth is and say we will not increase the rents on council houses going forward. The second point, if you allow me, is with regards to the additional amendment from Councillor Young, which I agree with wholeheartedly. Over a year ago, a local businessman came to this council and I noticed from the regeneration point of view and said that they would build high quality student accommodation. And had we worked collaboratively with them, that would have given this council a potential income of £500,000 a year. You could either take that as revenue saving or actually use the same business case as the previous report and capitalise it. You could add £10 million to the capital pot to invest across the board of Hartlepool. And that's why we have options appraisal, which we've already asked for by the Regeneration Committee, should be taken forward as quickly as possible because it will bridge the deficit gap that we wanted. More potential in capital investment in this town. So I wholeheartedly second or agree or third or whatever it is, Councillor Young's additional recommendation.
And I'll second that as well.
I suppose it's two observations to make. One would be, I think, the first part of the motion was about doing a report of the next financing policy committee, and that's scheduled for the 9th of March. Those members are going to be practical to do a report in that short time, so we'll get everything for the 9th of March. So I think the members want the report to go away, and I think we'd love to have an additional FMP making that for the 9th of March. And so we'll just clarify that, chair, otherwise we're not going to have the time to prepare the report.
Can I just ask a point of clarification for that? That we only have one third full council meeting in the cycle, and the additional
as we've done in the past, I think we have to bring them to this committee before I think it is. But I think we must have to move to tie this into the 9th of March. I'm looking at my colleague as I record with that. I don't think the dream is that it's feasible to bring that sort of report in that way of thinking of. So then we may be able to do it for the meeting.
Madam Mayor, sorry, can I just say this options appraisal has already been asked for by Regeneration Committee last week. So what I assume based on that recommendation should all be in progress.
I think
Chair,
I don't know whether the word's in progress with the director yet. Even if it has started, there isn't very much time to get the report, as I say, at the 9th of March. I think it would work to move the FMP before council on the 20th, and give us a little bit more time to do that. That's something we'll be led up to do at the moment.
Thank you, Madam
Mayor. I'd just like to say the same thanks to Paul Sinclair. I concur with Councillor Lee as well, too, as well. I felt that the rent increase around it was unfair. We are putting pressure on pressurised families. And it's been very ultimately explained the ways around that, and we avoid putting that question on paper.
I think what was said, Chair, I think at Finance and Policy Committee, when the event ladder was considered, we did set out to members the implications of different rent options, and the implications would be less housing investment, and notwithstanding the comments that Councillor Christopher Ray tells us about. I think given what members are asking for tonight, I'd probably suggest that we take the comments that members have made and actually defer this report and bring it back in its entirety. Because unless members want to report the vote of the plan as it stands, some of the other issues would not be fair to FMP. Would mean if this wasn't approved, it couldn't actually be implemented, depending on what happened at the next FMP. And if I get the feeling it will come back to council on the 20th of March.
There's been some very interesting comments made over the past few moments. And if we check specifically looking at the finance and policy first around the rent increase for our properties, it is worth noting, Madam Mayor, for those people who weren't in finance and policy, that actually we, as an authority and a housing provider, our rents are still some of the lowest on the market. Around there, we provide good quality homes for our residents. It's also worth noting that for the past 4 years, the government has forced us to reduce our rents by 1% for the past 4 years. So that's actually, there's been a reduction in rents of 4% for our tenants. And the government themselves have realised that they've pushed housing associations too far in making those cuts go back over, and it hasn't been sustainable. And I think the point is, the government wants us to invest in new housing stock. We as a council want to invest in new housing stock, and we want to do that because it's right and it's proper to deliver good quality, solid homes and put a roof over the heads of our families in this town. And the problem I have with making grand statements and getting up and saying we could do this, but actually the statement should be we could potentially do this. Is that if you don't call for this increase, we should still put the rent levels below what it would have been had we not made the cuts. You can immediately take 90 units off the figures that are there, and that means another 90 homes that we can't provide for Hartlepool families. There's comments there stating that there are desperate families out there who need good quality bungalows for families to be able to access for their young children or getting older. We can't deliver them if we haven't got the financial backing behind us and we haven't got the business plan in place to provide those houses. So that's 90 properties we can't deliver to those people. And we really say that, we don't want to do that. And it's always saying that, well, we can do it in another way. No, you could potentially do it in another way. Because if you're trying to use Wingley Garden Village as your golden goose, then Wingley Garden Village is going to be a 15-year plan. So you're not going to get all of those 106 contributions for a long time. And that means we can't deliver those houses that
desperately needed for our people, stuck in terrible privately rented accommodations. We can't provide those houses for potentially for 15 years because we won't make a sound financial decision tonight to build those houses for them. Because that's the grand scheme of things. We can say to them, you won't get a rent increase today, and we can offer them closing and looking about that if we walked away and did make that decision. But we're turning away 90 families, and we're also saying that we won't build those houses for potentially 15 years, as opposed to building 164 in 5 years. And for me, Chair, it's ludicrous, it's grandstanding. And we have the opportunity to provide for our families now. Why wait?
Since the report on financing policy isn't in the papers, can I just ask for a bit of clarity? Item 3.2 in this report says that the board's capital programme aims to deliver 164 units by investing up to £19.168 million and borrowing of £11 million. When we were in finance and policy, we were given that if the rent increase did not go ahead, we were still going to be delivering over 150 units, I believe. The corpus of the report?
It was 90 less.
It wasn't 90 less. We must ask for clarification.
I'm quite aware, Chair. The report was set out and set out the investment plan based on the participants in our paragraph 3.2 in Table 1. I think the reason the word aims to deliver were used was the decisions tonight allowed the borrowers approved, allowed the Council to seek to secure external grant funding. That's not guaranteed, but the Council has an extremely strong track record for securing that grant funding. Obviously, we can't give you a guarantee as we submit our bids. That investment plan, the amount set out in the table, aimed to deliver 164 units over that period. We set out in the FNP report that if the rent increase that was approved hadn't been approved, that would have reduced the rent income by £35,000. That would have reduced the borrowing we could have undertaken by just under £1.1 million. The grant loss, because we wouldn't have had the borrowing match from the grant, would have been around £660,000. That would have equated to 18 units. The other figure that's been referred to, the 90 units, is what would be lost if the rent goes into 4 full years. So effectively, it would be the number of houses lost each year. So that's where the 90 comes from, and that would be a reduction of 164.
And just says that's not what I asked for. I actually moved that we make a decision not to increase the rent on council board tonight. And I moved that into being seconded. And then if the group part doesn't go forward and the compatibility form, then so be it. But I have moved it.
Thank you, Chair. It isn't part of the report. We're asking to be thought on something that isn't part of the report.
Is it linked directly to what we're trying to do tonight?
Yes.
Okay.
So if that is the case, and it is the case that we're not going to be able to financially deliver what we want to deliver to council, that was voted for a finance and policy, then I'm a bit at a loss as to what we were doing in finance and policy when we agreed to put this through. The point is this, people need these houses. People are looking for, as Councillor Moore said, really good quality houses that they can move into, and these are houses for life. These are houses that they can move into and live in for the rest of their life, and they will have a great landlord. We will be the landlord. So if for £2.20 a week, they get, with additional to the rest, they get a good quality service and a good quality accommodation that we have built and we have procured to build, then actually that is worth every penny of that £2.20. And I would say that the report as it is now should be supported.
Just a quick question, just to ask clarity again. Are these time limited decisions, is there a huge issue with it being deferred for further information? And on the back of what Chris Little mentioned earlier, one of the proposals was about a 4-year hold on the rent. Are we expecting this to be a 4-year rise year on year to meet the match funding?
I'll answer the first question around the 4-year hold. Let's be honest, Councillor Black, if Council don't sit here tonight and vote this increase through tonight, they're not going to do it next year, or the year after that, or the year after that. And it's disappointing to hear councillors who were satisfied with the policy and supported these proposals at committee stage now saying that they think it could be another way and they're going to vote in favour. I didn't answer both of your questions. The report that came from the policy did suggest an annual increase, yes, in line with inflation, I believe, as will be the case for all the housing.
And sorry,
Mr.
Tandler, does this meet the goal tonight? Does that
affect the... It would potentially affect the interest rates on borrowing.
To build social and council housing for the town, I would like to know what the Labour alternative is to this. As you are saying there should be an alternative, I would like to tell me what that alternative is, because we presented it through the democratic process. I know, I'd like Labour to, with respect.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm sitting here for the last half an hour, so I'm sure many members of the public are flabbergasted to hear what is supposed to be a socialist party and another socialist party. That they are not going to support the construction of 164 new social houses that this council can be the landlord of and provide good quality housing for families who can't afford to get onto the housing ladder. I'm absolutely flabbergasted at this, because those who are suggesting the delay are only kicking the can down the road, and actually we could be getting on with this straight away, so that we can provide those services. Can we please, please, have some common sense?
There certainly is, an alternative, I see, and it's accelerating growth within our departments and ensuring that we have full review, that things go through and that there's no delays. We've got developers in the town who are wanting to build here, and we've got to be the council that welcomes that, and we've got to make sure it happens, and that was that staff to support it and to get those through as quickly as practically possible. Just in defence, it's quite ironic that I don't know how that describes your party, without being offensive really, and which party it is. Is it still a Brexit party? Certainly there's no objection to building houses here, but as a socialist, and I'm proud to be a socialist, it's got to be right terms for people. It cannot be done wrongly, because at the end of the day, the people out there are suffering, and they're suffering badly. And to put further pressure on them, if you want to live in this house, by the way, this is the increase to it. It's just unfair. So you can make up it if you like, but at the end of the day, the terms have got to be right. Because if they're not right, and they're too expensive, then people won't take them.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I won't respond to some of the accusations that have been made there, but what I will say is, let's look at the comparison again. We could have 164 new social houses ready for people to move into, so they can have a household, as Councillor Ewing said, for the rest of their lives on a reasonable rate of rent, compared to private landlords who can, large by and large, be unscrupulous. Okay, so that is the option on the table right now. If that's something you want to support, you vote for it tonight. If that's something you don't want to support, I'm sure there's many members of the public who won't like you that they actually.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I just want to go back to some of the comments made by Councillor Moore about there being a decrease in rents for the last 4 years. There's been a 4% decrease in rents, which means that families and people who are accessing council housing at the moment through Halfordbury Council have benefited from a 4% decrease. It has been acknowledged by government and housing associations that that decrease is not in line with the economics of the country, and therefore I don't think it's unreasonable for this increase to be made and for it to be year on year, because it is about quality, it is about getting this programme of delivery in place, built for people to move in. I don't think it's any more complicated than that. It's pure economics.
Thank you, Councillor. Right, quickly, Councillor Next. Chair, I just need to clarify, because for some reason they're taking that, I am saying not to build council houses, because they know we're not going to have rent, because I don't believe in a rent increase. And I'll use the example of the extra recommendation proposed by Councillor Young tonight. That potentially could give us a revenue income of £500,000 a year. But if you borrowed against it, you'd actually be able to increase the borrowing from 11 million to 21 million, and you'd actually be able to build more council houses. So they can't have it both ways. Like, you know, you can't pick and choose. What I'm saying is there are other ways that we would still be able to build, and would have been a proposal before us tonight to build council houses. And I also want to go back to the planning committee. When I joined this council, there would be more council houses. And like, you know, I've been on council for 11 years. We've had to reopen the house and rent the other houses. We've had almost 300 homes. We've got 300 homes before the graduating change. We used to get almost 20,000 towards building council houses or purchasing houses for a small home. We now have doubled the grant. That is the opportunity I want us to seize. Greater growth. And in my time as leader, Harley will be here, the fastest growing barrier in the whole of the Thames Valley. So we can do it. This is not the only way, and we should not be imposing rent increases when there's an alternative. And we should be leading by example and say council houses Yes, they are important, they are the best people should live in, but I believe that we can deliver council houses without the rent increase.
I think the difference of what's being proposed tonight is that what's in front of members of this parliament's report is called that fact. You have the financial business plan there to be able to deliver these houses now. What is being proposed tonight, or suggested from other members, is that we could potentially do it another way. You have the option of delivering houses within a 5-year plan, or you have the potential, maybe, of delivering houses if we grow the town enough. In 15 years, if we've built enough houses out if we need, or potentially more, if we underwrite a student accommodation by a private individual. Because that's not what is being told to members tonight. You're being told that there's a fantastic opportunity on our doorstep, there's no risk to the council, and without the opportunity to make even more money. But what's not being told is that as part of all of this, we would be asked to underwrite the whole deal, and we would put this council at serious financial risk, which is why any proposal put forward has to be seriously considered. It has to be seriously considered to the financial management of this authority so that we can underwrite everything we do when we move forward, Madam Mayor. And I would hope that we can cut this off and deal with it and get it over and done with so as to move forward and start building these houses and being
Councillor Brown.
Yeah.
Councillor
Cook.
Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So the difference between building out in 5 years or 5 years and 1 month to allow us to explore and to make sure that we don't have to put rents up for some of the poorest people is really going to bring everything. 1 month is what we're asking. Defer to 1 month. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you,
Councillor
Barnes.
Chair, I think
Councillor
Harrison?
Four.
Councillor
Hunter?
Four.
Councillor James?
Four.
Yes.
Councillor Lindbridge?
For.
Councillor Whipple?
For.
Councillor Lyons?
For.
Councillor Marshall?
For.
Councillor Miller?
Against.
Councillor Prince?
For.
Councillor Tony Richardson?
For.
Councillor Carl Richardson?
For.
Councillor Stockwell?
Against.
Councillor Tennant?
Against.
Councillor Ward?
Against.
Councillor Leo?
Against.
Council, we are robust and drafted in our layout of councils within our updated
appreciate the constraints that are put on councils. We want to make the greatest consequences and deal with the implementers and third to achieve support of council. Therefore, that will be a council should resolve to lobby the councils to be given more powers in disciplinary procedures which should extend to the business or the manager of the new advisors. Councillor Powers.
Thanks, Madam Chair. So, in looking at this motion, obviously there are two very recent examples of where it would have been much better had there been much more robust sanctions in place. It is a national problem, really, because councils are restricted as to how they can deal with anyone who doesn't adhere to the code of conduct. So we've had two very recent examples, but we've had examples in the past as well, in my time here, which is only 4 years coming up, but obviously before as well, where people have behaved inappropriately in their role as councillor. And I think that we need to really look much more closely as how we can deal with that. So as councillors, we need to be aware of the responsibility that the role brings. We need to be responding to officers and their staff and to the public in general in a much more or in a respectful way. We may disagree, as has been obviously highlighted this evening, we may disagree with each other quite a lot. But it's the way we express that disagreement that is important. And it should be done without being rude and without being disrespectful. We also need to realise that we're in this position to serve the residents of Hartlepool, not to use the position for our own gain and grandism. If councillors are not able to adhere to the code of conduct, which is based on the NOLA principles, then by failing to do that, sanctions should be used which actually go a little bit further than the present sanctions can. There should be a sanction which is to dismiss a councillor if they do not adhere to the code of conduct. There have been instances, which I have kind of touched on, where an appropriate sanction would have been dismissal. But unfortunately, that can't happen at this present time. Also, just to finish on that, I do think that when a councillor misbehaves in an inappropriate way, and they bring disrepute on the whole council, and we all suffer from people thinking that we are all doing the same sort of thing, which I think then leads to the public losing confidence in the council itself. So I do think a letter should be sent to both the LGA and an appropriate minister in order to express our concerns and to ask for a review of the sanctions policy for councils to make it much more reliable. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just for members of information this week, remember I've mentioned previously that the committee of the standards on public life would be reviewing member standards that came here. This week have been in touch with the LGA indicated that the model code of conduct will go out for consultation in March, so members that we've brought to members' attention and you'll be able to comment on it. Obviously, some of the recommendations that were made by the committee do require legislative change, so what this really, it feels like it's the first step forward, at least that we're going to get a model code that will be then brought to members.
Chair, there's a motion I feel as I can support tonight, but I'd just like the mover to ask to be considered whether they would add in the National Association of Councillors as well, as we are a member of that organisation, and it is a national organisation within the United Kingdom and within the likes of the LGA and the appropriate. I also think we help to extend it to the NAC.
Yes.
Thank you.
It's just that my understanding of the constitution is if it's committee or committees, then the item that we requested is that head of paid service review, and that would actually, if it's head of paid service, become the finance and policy. Mm-hmm. My understanding, since I put this motion, is there is a need to include this committee report that is due to be debated on the 9th of March. And if members saw fit on the 9th of March, we could refer that and this back to council.
Just for clarification, regarding that, will this come back to council then before the next municipal? Yes, that is a definite yes.
Thank you. Can we confirm though, and then clarification, sorry. This will be going to two separate committees, and I think it's already been identified that the first part of it, the neighbourhood services, as part of the review around the allotment procedures, will not be coming back in this municipal year, whereas the second part of it, referring to that of head of services, with just a clarification on that, because it is two separate.
I think the director's also indicated that the first part won't come back, and the second part will
and can impact on isolation and the issues that go with that.
some credit to Councillor Hamilton as well. I know Councillor Hamilton has been assisting with these ladies for quite a while now, and if it wasn't for Leslie literally banging on my door one day, she wanted me to meet with them. I wouldn't have met Barbara and Lynn, and they are lovely people, or maybe I might not have met them as soon as I had. So thank you, Leslie, for introducing me to those wonderful ladies. They've been on your record since, but it's been well worth it. I think, just to give a little bit of clarity, probably why this motion has gone this way as well, is that there's been a lot of talk about how the Metro Mayor in Manchester and various other places have been able to issue these bus passes quite easily to within those authorities. It's quite difficult here in Hartford and why it is valid, because what I didn't quite appreciate beforehand was how we commission our bus passes locally. We don't just commission on a Hartford basis, it's commissioned on a T-Valley wide basis, so all authorities would need to sign up to that. And it's not one that ran through the combined authority either, it's something we do as a collective basis. So unless we as an authority take that first step and say that we are going to support these ladies. And I know there is an awful lot of support out there, and I'm not going to let Harrison Fernay hand up at the back end. She stood up over a year ago, raising the champion in this cause. But unless we take that first step and write to the other authorities, because there's a very real possibility that they don't even know this is a problem. And I think during this whole process, it's identified a number of other issues around bus passing as well, which we will be tackling, but I wholeheartedly support this motion, and thanks for doing this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
but that doesn't tonight prevent members from approving the strategy, because it's a strategy about how we want to do all the talks. If the talks change, members are aware that throughout the year they would report to submit it. And again, then it allows us to move forward back to the MEP, building the members to complete the report to council. So I say, just for that clarity, I think members can still consider the recommendations that we've heard from the government's set out on the second page and the report. Just asking you to consider the approval recommendations, please.
Councillor Jones. I just wanted to clarify, Chairman, and I apologise to the Deputy Lord, obviously, Chair, to help you, because I don't think it would be the different things. But there will obviously need to be an appropriate training arrangement for the government to carry out the job.
And the assessment wants to send it here to show of hands.
Expected in this report also.
found the one that you said on the there's 11 in the coalition group, 10 Labour, 3 from the seat in the first, 4 socialists Labour, 3 independents, 1 from Britain, 1 vacant seat.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. That still doesn't confirm whether we have a Brexit-led council or a hardcore independent European council. I just wanted clarification. I know, Jane, you've obviously put out on social media. I just wanted whether there was official clarification for the council at all.
No.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This council has been since May last year been led by a coalition of councillors who were put inside by differences and working on it. But we laughed at that, don't we agree with you on that time, Craig?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I don't think Councillor Black's question is unreasonable. It's not unreasonable what happened when the people happened with the new government of health. It's a very fair question. Councillor Black himself is councillors, and we have no idea of that at all. So we know it's a coalition, and we'd like to know what their policies are, and what their maybe it is.
Yeah, Madam Mayor, thank you. Councillor Brown, hello. Councillor Shane Moran, leader of Hartlepool Borough Council, have been since May last year.
My question wasn't to mock Shane or group. I'm just asking for it was official clarification that it was now not the Brexit party, but it's Hartlepool, and that's all I asked also. My apologies, it's become a bit of a mock confess. That wasn't what I was trying to get.
Okay, thanks.
consideration would be given to having a dedicated enforcement team to tackle the amount of littering of dog fouling in the town. Can you please confirm that the can you please confirm what progress has been made to support the will of residents to have a decent enforcement team outlining how many FPNs have been issued in respect of litter, dog fouling, car parking since council for that. Thank you. And I reserve the right to speak.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The report will be taken to Neighbourhood Services Committee on the 18th of March 2020, which will cover the Council's current approach to civil and environmental enforcement, the existing service arrangements, figures detailing the action taken and the work undertaken more recently, and the proposal which will be performed. So we'll come to the Neighbourhood Services Committee.
Councillor Stephen.
Madam Mayor, I want to hear all the questions being answered in its entirety. I have the numbers on how many fines have been issued since the last council meeting, and that is clearly stipulated in this question, and I'll expect an answer tonight because no notice has been given on that.
With respect to the car parking charge notices, there are 2,329 have been issued, which actually includes PCN's issue of operation program. Regarding dog fouling, there have been 20 leads, and that includes fouling dogs off leads and flights have been smoking at this week. Those are the things so far. But of course, more detail will be given at the committee on the 18th of March.
Sorry, can I just come in for 1 second just to have noted the time? And if members are agreeable to be more related to the council procedure rules, in that we go past 9 o'clock, say tonight.
With respect, I can give you a written answer in due course, ahead of that meeting if that suits. If not, then we'll just have to wait until that meeting.
It's on the list. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I would just like to say that in all my time on the council, I have never experienced a question we put forward to a member where we haven't had a fully articulated response exactly detailed what was requested. And I don't think this could have been more clear. Can you please confirm what progress has been made to support the village residents to have a dedicated enforcement team and outline how many fixed-penalty notices have been issued in terms of litter, dog fouling, and car parking since council on October? So I don't know how more clear it could have been. And what we've been given tonight is it doesn't matter the will of the full council, which is supposed to be the sovereign body of the council. It doesn't matter because there's a report coming and just make do with that on the 18th of March. That is not how this council's operated in the past. And I don't expect it to operate like that in the future. And I would just like to register my own abject disappointment that the amount of litter and dog fouls going on in the town that was raised last October still is not being tackled in this town.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm Nick. I've reported maths, laws, and all the meetings come to town in this room when I have got the case on top there. I've actually done a walk around with the enforcement officers where they find the drivers and have the police on and leaving the litter on the mall. And it always tells me that in an area, we've got an awesome road for the black spot scene as well as the sea wall, the sea front wall. And if you know somebody who's re-offended and getting their dogs foul anywhere and they're not picking it up, you know it's roughly the time and date. The enforcement team will go out at that certain time. And like, there's only a few of them to cover a whole town. I'm not sticking up for them. But I know personally that some of the team are fine on me on a regular basis, especially from the vehicles that were alleged out on the walk, driving on the A689 and Grand Prix doesn't say where I am. But those, these people are all around me, I'm trying, I've done it with them. I've been listening on Saturday, it's great if you want to come and help us down Morley Drive, because you get lots of litter down there. We do have best councils as well. So
recently launched a consultation exercise and the council is committed to engaging with the consultation which closes on the 20th of April this year. The government consultation is aimed primarily at business operators, but there is also consideration to the councils including enterprise zone status and business rates, changes to planning regulations or infrastructure, education and skill potential and public-private partnerships. By submitting a response to government, the council will be able to be relevant to local businesses, landowners, and also the chief by the combined authority to make their representations that protect Hartford itself and the Borough Council's interests. Further to responding to the formal government consultation, Madam Mayor, the council will write to the now Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, to make representations advocating that Port of Hartlepool is critical to the economic performance of Hartlepool and indeed the wider Teme Valley region, and therefore it should be granted through port status. I can confirm that on the announcement of the consultation of the Freeport, I wrote to the Teme Valley Mayor Ben Houchen requesting that all language that he uses and moving forward always includes the Port of Hartlepool, not just that Tees. And that as a member of the cabinet within the combined authority, I will continue to fight for our inclusion within any Freeport bid. And I personally will not sign off on any bid that moves forward from the Tees Valley that does not include the Port of Hartlepool in any bid that moves forward to include the Tees side of the Tees Valley.
Firstly, I'd just like to thank Shane for the full response that he's given tonight because it's a huge opportunity. And I'd like to just put on record and commend Shane for his response to see back to you answer this
question. Thank you, Madam Mayor. No, I was really thought we'd probably get it by the next question. I just wanted to make a matter of fact there. The Chief Secretary of the Treasury, if you're wrong, we're going to see that chancellor of the just making that noted. I would like to be saying to the Chief Secretary of the Treasury, not the Chancellor.
Sure.
Come on,
next week. Question C. It's been a long time. Questions on members of the House of Representatives on the Fixed and Power Council and different mayor authority for personnel. On D, minutes of the meetings held by the Fixed and Power Authority and the Fixed and Power Council for personnel. I think, take a deep breath, I think that's the goal of business. Can I thank you all? It's been a long night. We've discussed a lot of things. Thank you very much to the members of the public for the presentation as well. I hope to see you on the 4th of March. Everybody come and hope you all have a good night.
Please stand.